Hi, everyone. Welcome and thank you for coming to Habitat Now. I'm your host, Aaron Shea, and we have the honor today of being visited and visiting the studio of artist Martin Blank. Martin has been a member of the Habitat family for decades, and it is an honor to have him. He is an amazing person, an amazing being, and super positive about his work and his career, and we're grateful to have him. And so I wanted to welcome Martin, and I want you to say hi to everybody.
Hey, good morning, everyone.
Hi, Martin.
Good morning, hi. Martin.
This is so fun, right? We just get to connect and see each other and see everyone's smiles. It really makes my day. It's a pretty exciting.
Hello, Martin. How you doing?
Hey, hi.
You make our day too.
Oh, bless you all. Bless
For
you all.
For sure.
Look at you. Mwah, mwah. What a treat. you know, it's interesting. I have, as I was talking with Aaron and wanting to share with my Habitat family, my friends, the artists that are here, the collectors, you know, this is a really unique family. This is a really special, it's a special community. I've prepared some videos. If you've seen the videos, I've edited them. I've added some new pictures to them. So I try to make each talk a little bit different, a little bit new, and I keep editing and re-editing. Just like life, it keeps on unfolding and shifting and changing. So I wanted to start out with something pretty fun. And also, please feel free to, you all know how to use the comments and questions section of your Zoom. You know, feel free to throw in a question or a comment and Aaron can read to them, because this is a dialogue as well. Got lots of video. So I was often asked once in the middle of a lecture, Martin, how do you use a university? I love the questions you get from university students. They're always, how do you know when you've made it? And I thought for a minute, and I went, when you've been sued, that's how you know you've made it. So I have another thing that happened to me this week that I want to share with you guys, and I hope it works. It's to speak about it's about ripples in life and your actions and the things you do now and how you have no idea how they spread out across the pond, they intersect and they weave, and you're not going to know how you've impacted other people's lives and what simple gestures you've made have acted upon others. So I met a Dr. Mark Sobel years and years ago, and he is a foot surgeon, a specialist. And who would have known that he wrote this book, okay? This book is called The Peroneal Tendon. This is a heavy duty medical book. I'm not even gonna open it up, because if I open it up, you're all gonna be like, ugh. Although the doctor's there, you might go, oh yeah, I know that tendon, and it inserts over here and connects to here. Okay, so he sends me this book, unbeknownst to me, he gives me a lovely little recognition. And on the second page of this book is this, one of my drawings that I gave to him on, because I knew that he was a doctor of a specialist. Can you see that?
Yep.
Yeah.
So I thought that was really that. So, okay, you know what? I guess I made it in some fashion or another. I'm in a medical textbook. Woo! It's pretty crazy. It's pretty crazy. So I'm also sitting on a wobbly stool, and I saw, if you see me doing this a lot, it's because I'm unconscious and I'll try to sit still. And as you may notice, I do a lot of, I'm kind of a kinetic person. This enhances my wobble ability too. I can even spin all the way around. All right. So this last year was quite an extraordinary year. And one of the things that Aaron and I thought we'd share with you is a lovely video that Charles Shepard produced from the Fort Wayne Museum of Art. And Repose in Amber is a sculpture that I created that was in downtown Chicago. And many of you know it. But it now has its home in the lobby of the Fort Wayne Museum of Art. And they produce this pretty fun video. And for those who don't know me, for those who know me, I think you'll get a kick out of seeing its new permanent home. So Aaron, what do you think? You wanna run that one?
Yeah, let's give everybody a quick morning coffee view into your studio too.
Oh, that's even better. Thank you, Aaron. Aaron's got my notes. So you guys, when I walk into my studio, This was not this morning, but just the other day in the winter light. I just wanted to share what it's like to come into my studio.
So we're taking over your screens, everybody. So feel free to get off speaker view if you want to, but either way you'll see my screen. So we'll start with this little glimpse into Martin's studio. Again, thank you, Martin, for being here.
Thank you, Aaron.
Here we go. Click on the old play button. What a beautiful, beautiful light is coming through into your studio from a high, is it a high point? Those windows up there?
Yeah, so it's the low sun, and only in the winter does it blast through and just everything explodes with light. And it's just, I walked in and it was like, you're kidding me. it was just an absolute treat to witness that first thing in the morning.
Thank you for sharing with us, Martin. It's a great thing to enjoy coffee too and really explore a lot of beautiful work in your studio. So here we go. This is the interview, everybody. I'm going to make sure my sound is on share so we can all hear the interview go. Here we go. See Daisy.
This will become what we're known for. A work like Repose at Amber is an addition to the collection that we could never have hoped for and now have achieved. This particular gallery room needed a certain kind of piece to be what it really was meant to be, and Repose at Amber is that piece.
When I was young, I was an absolute pyromaniac and I loved origami. I also used to blow giant soap bubbles and make inflatable rooms that you could wander through. I'm a very kinetic person. I'm that kid with ADHD.
Okay, so, as I was saying, this is really uncomfortable.
I vibrate, you know, I get, that's what I call enthusiasm and excitement. I'm vibrating and this is awesome. And when I'm sculpting, I'm like, yes, there's just a spontaneity and a joy to putting components together. And I step back and it's like, it's resonating. And it's that tree, it's that landscape, it's the cliff that I stood on. Also childlike wonderment. You know, when you're a child, you're uninhibited and you're spontaneous.
Martin himself is in the top 8 of the most important artists of the 21st century. So this is historic in the sense that this is a strong commitment on behalf of this institution to celebrating the best of American sculpture.
To make great work, you have to be willing to lose everything all the time. You have to be comfortable with failing. And people, you know, oh, you're an artist, you must have so much fun. And I'm like, fun? Are you like sometimes I'm on the floor crying. You know, it's ugly, it's horrible. What have I done? I've just spent $10,000 and I have, you know, this is terrible. That usually fades away a little bit later. I get my act back together again and I start over.
It's a bolder, braver thing to do what Martin does and get his things around him and start going, yeah, that works. Oh, but I don't now like the space that makes over here. So let's do this so that space works and the solid works. And to not, I mean, honestly, you don't know exactly what's going to happen. This piece, Repose in Amber, is such a great piece of proof that Martin's approach works. Time and time again, he gets us to where we need to go, and it's a beautiful place to be.
The goal was to create individual islands, but that as you walk in, everything foreshortens, and you just see what, abstractly speaking, that this one would represent a head, this would be the big torso, and then the nice round hips, you know, long, elongated calf section, and then down at the end are the toes. You know, when you're in bed, your toes are just wiggling. All you see is your toes wiggling at the end of it, and the sheets at the end, and you're always so cozy, and like, oh, I just love climbing into bed. And so that was the wiggling, happy toes just down at the far end. Some may see it, some may not, but it was pulled out and stretched out so that from certain vantage points, you could see the totality of this expression. And that was the goal of the piece. And I think we did it. This is called three-dimensional light. There's a volume in here forever when the lights are on where this frequency of rose light or amber light is always going to be projected and collecting in here because the frequency of the light is getting changed as it passes through the color. And it's always going to give you this, I mean, that's magic. This is, we call it a stone grind. I intentionally pitted the surface so that you would look at the surface. Here, I've left it open and untouched from the furnace heat so that you can look in and see the veiling and experience another layer of color, another pattern.
You spend some time with just this one sculpture, and I don't think you go away the same person. Your heart and your imagination are gonna get played with somehow. You know, you go home and after the meal, instead of sitting in front of the tube, you went downstairs in the basement and you started building a strange radio or a set of, you know, bionic devices. And you think, why am I doing this? And I didn't even do it right. I'll do it better tomorrow night.
You know, for me, great art should be like an incredible piece of music, you know, where the waves, they resonate and that particular tone hits you. And you hear what that artist was trying to communicate. And I'm trying to communicate a wonderment and an enthusiasm and a reflection back on the natural world. You know, and we think of our lives as concrete, but they're just this little 80-year-old blip. You know, then it's over. So I want to do something with this life, and I want to make an object that when you walk up to it, you feel it.
That was incredible, Martin.
Oh, thanks, Aaron. It was just an amazing adventure to have the honor and the ability to create that piece.
That piece was on the public art tour for 10 years, right? In Chicago.
Downtown Chicago.
Yeah. That's amazing. Yeah. That is amazing.
I think one of the most interesting things too is all of the exploration is that let me just back up because one thing that keeps ringing in my head is a quote from Emerson, one of the great poets. And he says, nothing great ever happened without enthusiasm. And that's just so true. And it also, nothing great in my interpretation never comes without a big dose of anxiety and insecurity, but it's what do you do with that afterwards? And how do you keep going? How do you keep the vision in your head? You know, so I'm a very curious person. I'm always questioning and wondering. And I see the whole world in pictures. I swear to God, every object pops up like right about up here. Like when I close my eyes, it's like, bing, there's this like photograph right up here. And making art for me is translating emotions into three-dimensional objects. You know, how do you get that content? How do you get that spark in there? And it comes from a sense of perseverance and a holding on to a belief, not being overwhelmed by the terror of failure. And I know I'm just speaking really honestly with you all. You know, I know every human, it sort of seems to be the human dilemma, our doubt, our second questioning. Now, Picasso often said that the real art happened when all the visitors leave, right? And that's the ego in your head. I suck, I'm no good, I wish, pardon my French, I do use profanity. This is a PG audience here, a parental, anyways, you know what I'm trying to say. Yeah, parental permission. Right. So anyway, Repose in Amber was 2 years of my life to create that piece. And we had to invent a lot of equipment and tools, and I had a lot of wonderful help. Michael Church and Deborah Webb and Brian Kuntz, those are the John Harvey was popping in and out of there. Those folks were really instrumental in helping me figure out how does one create at that scale. And I'm going to be giving a lecture in December about the actual making of that that piece in more detail, because there's a lot of other things that I want to share and cover with you guys.
How was working with Fort Wayne? How was working with them?
God, that was awesome. Have you guys been to Fort Wayne? It is an awesome little place. They have great restaurants and little towns. I wish it were easy to just hop on a plane and get there. Amanda and Charles and all of their staff, I felt like they had I just felt like I had the red carpet rolled out, and everyone was so enthusiastic, and suddenly seeing it in place and in situ. Yeah, I rolled up and there was a banner on the building of Repose and Amber there. People don't know this, Aaron, but the building got sold, and there were some complications with the owners after the second owner, and they were terrified of, I don't want to go into that. They ended up taking and dismantling the piece, unfortunately, and putting it in the basement. And it sat in the basement of Chicago for years. And it was Corey and Ferd connected with some folks and got some people to purchase it. And
me too.
Donate it. And you too. I'm sorry. I didn't have phone conversations with you, my brother. So it was quite an amazing experience. Let's give a shout out to Habitat and all the wonderful people there. Ow! Because that piece now sits in the lobby of the Fort Wayne Museum of Art. How lucky am I as an artist to have that opportunity? And I made that, I mean, it's just sort of, oh, it's just, it just gives me goosebumps thinking about that.
Yeah.
But it ended up out of the basement, and you guys found the right people to buy it and donate it to the museum. And God, it was something else.
Yeah, that is an insanely impressive piece. If you haven't seen it, make your way to Fort Wayne to check it out, because it is, like Charles said in the video, it's life-changing. Seeing that down the hallway, exploring it, you can spend all day looking at that piece. That brings me to the next part of our presentation about every single architectural piece you've ever created is now in a museum, in the front of a museum too, right? Is this what's going on?
Yeah, it's... you know, if I could speak back to little Marty Blank, hey, buddy, it's gonna be okay. I swear to God, it's gonna be okay.
Yeah. I got one behind me right here, right? This is
That's actually thank you to Rosalind Pohl and the Benaroya family and the Tacoma Museum of Art. That is in the front lobby of the Tacoma Museum of Art, right when you walk in the door, and it's in memory of an incredible gentleman, Melvin Pohl. And he commissioned me in 1997, you guys. I made that piece. It was like the first architectural piece I ever made. I had never fused glass before. I actually went up to Pilchuck and poured ladles on the marver and threw rocks in the glass. And I threw wood in the glass and I laid out all these tiles. And I came in and I showed them and he said, yeah, go for it. But what I didn't realize is it wasn't going to work. And so Dick Weiss actually taught me how to cut glass. And I went up to the Pratt Fine Arts Center and started cutting glass and fusing these panels. And I realized that, hey, this is going to work. And the challenge with that piece is that I had the front and the back to compose. Every piece that goes in the front dramatically affects how you view it from the back. And you also had to come in very, very close to the piece. And so the whole mood, the cascade, the top left is the rippling waters, and it cascades over into the middle where's the deep waterfall. And then it gets very placid and quiet down at the far end. So again, creating a visual experience and a physical experience for people to share as they experience and walk through that sculpture.
I love the way that the sculpture moves around as if it's alive. It's in the front, it's in the back. There's depth, there's texture.
Yes, absolutely, Aaron. And also light, it sits in this museum with such beauty because it is a rose window. You know, it the light comes through every day and it changes the mood of the lobby, and the intensity of the greens shift throughout the daylight. I want to share with you guys a little secret behind this piece. While I'm installing it, we're running these bars of metal through, and it's all like, and I bang, 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 and there's all this kind of cacophony of noise, and the door opens up, and he says, could you keep it down? I'm practicing. Unbeknownst to us at the time, Melvin Pohl was an extraordinary opera singer, and he was getting ready for a presentation. I don't know if it was in Lincoln Center or if it was in the, I don't remember exactly where it was, but he was an amazing opera singer. And all of a sudden we quiet down and this piano starts playing and he's busting out opera. Nessa Dora. And we're all just like, we stopped working and we all got shivers and we were like, just sat there and listened to Melvin Pohl sing opera. And it wasn't Nessa Dora. It was some, but that's one of the few opera pieces that I can remember on the top of my head. The gift of that. And look how lyrical this piece is. This is the bars of music. This is a flow. And it has a cadence to it, and it's a coda. There's an end, a beginning and an end. What a gift, huh? What truly a gift. And I was at one point on the floor, pounding my hands in the ground going, what made me think that I wanted to make this sculpture? Am I crazy? It wasn't working. There's always a moment where the piece just does not work. And that's the true moment of reckoning, but that's the true moment of insight, where you have a decision to give up or you have a decision to persevere and calm down and trust. Life is so much about trust, right? Get on an airplane, it's mm-hmm. trust. Walk across the street, it's trust. Believing in yourself, believing in the fact that there is a spark, there's something that you're connected to that is going to enable you to achieve your vision. What is the old saying? God wouldn't have given you the ability if he wouldn't have given you the talent if you didn't think you had the ability to create it. Someone knows it better than I do. But this is absolutely an affirmation of that.
Continuing on your installations, this is a beautiful one that I had experienced when I came around into the gallery to check out before it came to fruition and after. There's a beautiful book published that you did sharing the Fluent Steps here. This is a marvel. And I'm sure everybody has seen it, I'm sure, person.
Yeah, I'll tell you guys, that was 2 years. Again, it's interesting. Most of these large projects take about 2 years of my life. Do you have another shot of this?
That's the only shot I have at the moment,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay, one thing to realize is that, and this leads right into our next segment of invention, Aaron. This section to the left is 80 feet of sculpture. And I had never worked at this scale before. And God bless the museum because I had a residency. My residency, there you go. Oh, nice, Aaron. Go ahead and click on a few of those. Because a lot of these images people aren't going to see. This morning light coming up through. This is the dew and the fog collecting on this piece. There's no Photoshop to any of these images. For those who have seen it lately, it is now every year I go down, I donate my time and my team, and we clean it. And we invented special tools, these gigantic water picks. And we get up there with water picks on ladders. No one else is going to go in with a ladder. And we blast it with water picks to clean it. And it now actually does have a life back to its original. Unfortunately, the middle element got destroyed because of weather, this gorgeous tree. Someday I'm hoping to get some funding with the museum and recreate the tree that goes back there. But again, this comes to the human spark. It comes to with this idea of enthusiasm, and not enthusiasm in a manic way, but a joy and a wonderment to create. We all toy, every one of us has something that we love to do, that we're drawn to do. And it can be even learning. Reading is one of those acts of a need to grow, a need to be something beyond what we are presently. I want to throw this out there right now. I consume books. If you have favorite books, please send me a link. Before this conversation ends, will share with you some of my favorite books, and some might be a surprise to discuss. But I had a residency at the museum. And I made these, I wanted to create steam. I would sit there and steep my tea in the morning and I would watch my steam just go through the phases of matter and just disappear. I mean, that is the absolute definition of ephemeral. It's just there. And it's also you know, the molecules are doing nothing but expanding, and so the density is less and you can't see it, but they're still there. I mean, that is magic. That is a wonderment to unexplainable phenomena that happen around us because of our limitations of our five senses. So how would you create an object that represented steam, something that was fluid, that was changing? And I brought these elements and I put them out in the reflecting pool, and I grabbed Tim and Susan Warner and Tim Close, and I dragged them out into the pond, and I said, wouldn't this be incredible? Wouldn't this be something to make this sculpture flowing, dancing across? We'll catch the morning steam. We'll catch the undulation of the wind. I mean, wind, think about wind. Wind is so powerful, but we never see wind. Okay, we only see the effect of wind. You know, it's like gravity. We have no idea about it. We're understanding more about it, but yet it'll pull planets to each other. It'll cause, you know, asteroids to collide. It keeps us spinning around the sun. Happy birthday, everybody. You know, one of these magical things that just is, but we only see the effects of it. So these are the things that I think about. And one element, and then this is the second iteration. Thank you, Aaron. I know we have a timeline, and you guys do know I love to share with you guys. I want to share one little quick element. And this, and then after that, maybe we can move to the video of the equipment.
Sure.
When one makes something in a 3-foot diameter glory hole and fills the glory hole in an hour, it's just, and you're just slithering and sweating around this massive element, and then you bring it inside and put it on a 10-foot tripod, and it's above you in your head and it's almost touching the ceiling, and you've got 10 of them floating around you, and your heart's pounding. One, because you don't want it to fall on you, but two, because it's actually starting to speak to you. It's beginning to have a life of its own. You carry this piece carefully out and you place it in a 207-foot reflecting pool that's 60 feet wide. And I'm telling you, talk about popping a bubble. It looked like a little tiny piece of popcorn floating on the water. And I went, I am so screwed. I have no idea how I'm going to manage that. And I want to share with you, because you'll get the sense of this a little bit later. You have to surrender in life. When you're most challenged, you have to surrender and give up, because I was consumed with what this piece would become. It's a very prominent, obviously a prominent, important piece to me and my career. And I had to give it everything. So I had my dog and we're walking through the fields, and I kept saying, today, Martin, you're not an artist. Today, you are nobody. You are nothing. Stop. Thought would come in, stop, I'm nobody. I would say, and I'm scared at this point, because we got like a year to finish it, and I didn't know exactly how the field should be. So I sat down under my alder tree. I don't know if you guys know this, but I meditate, and I love meditating, and I don't do it every day, but every time I do it, it's a benefit to me and my wife, poor thing. It keeps me grounded. And so I thought, you know, today's a good day. I'll sit down and meditated under my alderwood Bodhi tree. And and I am telling you, I just finally kept saying, I'm not an artist. I quit today. Today I'm done. Because the tape kept rolling, the pressure kept rolling. And I finally relaxed. I finally kind of got to this point where, like, I give up. Yeah, I just give up. Fuck it. I give up. It'll come to me. And I am not joking. I open my eyes and I look across the field, and there's this whole row of alder trees. And I saw this cadence. You know, it was an irregularity, but it had a pattern. It was a fractal pattern. And I suddenly saw this beat, and I went, my God, that is exactly what I want my piece to look like. An unpredictable pattern, but yet a pattern, a landscape that's revealed to us that will give me an in and out and a depth that's unrecognizable, but yet it feels right. And I started laughing and I'm like, well, I guess I should give up more often. And I say that to everyone, give up more often, you guys, because clarity and a sense of well-being will arise from that. And that leads me to a beautiful quote. Again, Ralph Waldo Emerson is just, you know, one of the romantic poets. Romanticism is really something else, where you believe that nature really, you believe in a connection to the natural world. You believe that there's something bigger than you, and you believe in the equalization of mankind, that everyone is created equal. It's a beautiful concept that seems to have been lost, but I do notice that many artists speak to this quality. Many artists and collectors, I think that's why we all resonate with each other. But one really beautiful one, you guys, is if I can find it, and this just rings so true with me, is finish every day, be done with it. Finish every day, be done with it, my interpretation of it. Because when you wake up, tomorrow is a new day. It's the beginning. And yesterday's mistakes were yesterday. And tomorrow's mistakes and failures are tomorrow. And all we have is right now. And all we have is the moment where we're sharing and creating. And I just love that. What a relief. I can give up on yesterday. Mm-hmm. I hang to that. I want to be angry. I just gotta cling to that. No, give up on it. It's a beautiful day. Wake up. Here you go. I love this one. This one makes just warms my heart. Okay. Every day, every moment that you're angry is 60 seconds that you lack happiness. Bravo! All right, Aaron.
Let's keep going, Martin. We got a beautiful installation here that you've done as well.
99 Church Street. Are downtown, two blocks up from Ground Zero. That was an extraordinary experience. And it is literally in a beautiful pocket park, two blocks outside of Ground Zero. It's part of the World Trade Tower campus. And you'll see images of this later on with Larry and Clara Silverstein, who graciously gave me this opportunity to create in there. Larry lives upstairs and sees it every day. It needs lots of maintenance. It needs to be cleaned. If you see it in the winter, it's so exciting to walk around the corner and there it is. And it's steam, you know, it's the steam, it's the clouds. Every angle you walk around it, it changes from every viewpoint and every angle, it speaks something different to you. And it's a fountain. And you'll see more about it later on. There'll be other talks about it. Aww.
So we have a video here Martin has put together for us to enjoy, talking about inspiration. So it's about 8 minutes long or something. So feel free to enjoy this.
Turn up your music. We spent a lot of time on this. A lovely videographer, Ethan Steinman, worked with me on this. And you're kind of getting a glimpse into my whole life, you guys. And right. I added some new images just this week to try to refine it. It really shares how I think, my thought process in the sense of what are my inspirations. It's quite clear. My heroes, there's my heroes, my wife, my two boys. I think you really get it after seeing this.
You guys control your own volume, so feel free to raise it up or lower it down as it plays. So enjoy.
Yeah, crank up the music. There's a lot of lovely little editing in here.
Tell me if I'm going crazy, but everything you said amazed me. Seems too easy on the ear to be something I should here too. You told me to just simply wander rather than take shelter under, and open my heart to the thought that life is something you're not caught at. Too easy to get lost in progress. I didn't see you there in thy dress, and suddenly the world seems so small. We fit it all inside our front hall. Edison would spin in his grave to ever see the light that you gave. Don't wanna take it nice and slow here. Don't wanna waste a minute more, dear. The universe just vanished out of sight. Smarter primate. Maybe it's the beer I'm drinking. Maybe I've stopped overthinking. Baby, you're the words and chapters, the sweetness in the morning after. You are the cry that turns to laughter. You're the hope that ends disaster. The universe just vanished out of sight, and all the stars collapse behind a pitch black night, and I can barely see your face in front of mine, but it is no. It's just an empty space, and all the stars can disappear.
All the colors are crackling, the leaves are alive. With a note from you, I keep written inside. Frozen air surrounds your eyes. As you speak, fountains collide. With a mouthful of stars, I trip over my feet. You've blown me. Misled my spark. Memories of you fading into the past. To keep you inside, freeze your kiss so it lasts. You've blown me away. I can't hardly
my spark.
Wow, that was impressive, Martin. Thank you for sharing that with us.
Yeah, you guys, Aaron, can you, there we go, thank you. Yeah, you guys just witnessed my whole life. I don't know about you, but it sort of takes me taken aback. Every time I see that, it's really moving, because that really is sharing with you a lot of the, it's just simply sharing with you my life and what I've created and what I think about and how I think. Nazarian just always tells us to take the plunge. You know, she actually wrote The Color of, I forgot the name of the movie and book, Color of Water, The Shape of Water, excuse me. Yeah, she wrote The Shape of Water, beautiful book about relationships. You know, Whitman is always talking to us about a path and a road that we're on, and we may not notice, we may not know it, but some of us, we've all been on it our whole lives. And it's about understanding that we're on this path. Frost speaks to us about a path less traveled or just traveled, or are you on the right path? And that comes with a sense of understanding of who we are and our own personal journey. And that's really what you just witnessed, is this is my journey. And every one of you has this beautiful journey that you're on, and you're sharing it with me, and I get to share it with you. And what a lovely relationship we've all shared over the years. As we've all gotten to know each other, we're all getting a little grayer in the sides, and we've all had loss, we've all had great joy. And is that not a life well lived? I mean, it is a life well lived, my friends. And that's why I do what I do. You know, I can't, I'm sorry. I don't know why I'm getting so emotional. I think it's because of the importance and the human spirit and the importance to live a life well lived, to do it, to not be held back by my fear, to not be afraid of what others are going to say, or not to not, but to do, even though you're under those, you know, even though you are confronted with that. So it's the wave. It's the wave. I have a lot to say about duality. I don't know where we're at with timing right now, and how everyone's attention span is.
But you're doing great. We're doing great, Martin. Worry not. This is amazing stuff. And that was truly a glimpse into your life. I recognize years of my life looking at that too. It's amazing how intertwined we all are together, right? Loving this medium. It's true.
Yeah.
You did mention about, you know, the material never limits you, and your ability to push past and figure it out. And I saw something in that video was a wheel on the end of a blowpipe. Yeah. Can you tell me a little bit about that? That's pretty neat.
Yeah. So as most of you realize, you know, most glass objects are handheld. You know, it's like a little bird's nest. And I love, you know, I love from the smallest little tiniest little pieces. But I also love as those who know me, I have installation pieces where you walk around and you have to confront the piece. It's a very visceral experience. It's different to walk around a sculpture like a Sarah, where it's nothing more than a curved piece of metal, or Kenneth Nelson, where these tensegrity structures, and it becomes an architectural statement, and architecture is describing and redefining our reality. Very important. But when you walk up to the intimacy of a pedestal piece, you then walk around and your focus point and your perspective and your periphery narrows down. And I was always frustrated with the material that it's so darn hard to work hot glass. It just is. And so in order to blow something, Aaron, that you know, every foot past the fulcrum, the weight doubles. Okay, old Archimedes here, right? And we had only been taught to throw a 2x4 under the blowpipe, and two people on either end pick up your pipe and carry it over to yoke and put it down. And then I'd go into the glory hole and heat, and then it would come back out and they'd pick it up with a 2x4, bring it back to the bench and drop it down. And I'm trying to sculpt something that has a presence that just at scale, I just got bored with just this scale, the human scale. I'm limited to the tendons. I'm limited to the muscular structure and the bone. Okay, so I was up at the glory hole and I'm pushing, and I just said, if I just had a cart that could hold this piece in place, then it would take all the leverage off. So I just said, build it. And I went to my studio and I Pete Sasaki built this cart, and we went to Pratt Fine Arts Center and we gathered up this huge mass of glass and I hooked it underneath the bar and I let go. And it was like, oh my God, look, Ma, no hands, you know, and the piece all of a sudden starts to sag. And then we realize there's another Newtonian problem, torque. Oh my God, we couldn't spin it because it's going burp. So we came out of the hook and we flipped this thing over. And I said, I need a wheel. And that week I went and I popped out a wheel on the end of the blowpipe, and Fred Metz helped me out, another brilliant human being on the planet. And I realized that I could just spin this piece. And I had a 10-inch wheel, and I kept saying to my team, I want to give you a bigger wheel. And glass blowers are stubborn. They don't want to break tradition. We want to stick. This is how, it's like being an old Jewish man. It's tradition. That's how it's done. It's how you do it. So again, I was like, well, sorry, there's got to be a better way. And I built the bigger wheel. And you'll see photos of some massive pieces of glass where the wheel, I finally got them to use the bigger wheel. They popped it on and suddenly they're all like, wow, Martin, thank you. This is so much easier. And all these crazy heat shields. So I never let the process or a tradition get in the way of what I need to create and what I need to say and how I'm going to get to it. The reason the Museum of Glass worked is because I didn't care about technique. We just took a ladle and we dumped it, and I spun it out like a pizza, stuck a tube on it, and in a minute we had a 3.5-foot rondel. That would have taken an hour and a half to blow, and step by step, we had that in 15 minutes. We had a 3-foot element. I needed hundreds of elements to create at that scale. So again, that tool then opened the door and my ability to create on a new level. And so Aaron has, I'm working on a wonderful, amazing piece right now. We have two little videos here. And I was asked to create a sculpture in the abstract, figurative abstract series. And it's a convergence of a greater man. It's a convergence of mankind. It's a convergence of humanity. And one of the characters that's in this piece is Buddha. And how am I going to make Buddha in my style? And how am I going to make Mary in my style and Gandhi in my style with abstract elements and create a passage that one walks through and gives people an experience? So Aaron, if you would show, directly speaking to the cart and the wheel, this sculpture, now I don't want you to think that scale is the important part. It's not. It's that the object needed to be made at that scale in order to complete the piece. So it's not about big is better. In art school, we always said, if you can't make it good, make it big. And if you can't make it big, paint it red. And if you don't have any red, paint it blue. That was the old art school joke. But you see this cart right here. The cart, the difference is glass blowers go from the glory hole to the bench. The glory hole to the bench. I'll talk about it after you watch this, if you're interested. Go ahead. And does it have any sound to it?
Yep.
That little sketch was the first thing in the morning. There's Buddha's head. We've been working on this now for about 4 hours. Perfect example of the cart and the staging area.
The size of that wheel.
This piece is so heavy that we cannot pick it up off the yoke. We have to roll the cart, the shields, everything that we've been working to the annealer. Line it up.
I close first.
Open the annealer doors. Follow that blue line because it's a little teeny hole.
Oh my God! Does it get any smoother than that?
That was extraordinary day, you know, and what a responsibility to be creating with these potent world these potent icons, and yet have it still look like a Martin Blank in my aesthetic, in my sense of aesthetic. Did you guys all see how that? So the cart, Aaron, can you just pull up a click an image of the cart?
Let me see what I can do. Give me 1 second. There is no real image. It's only in the video. Let me find it.
Yeah, like just freeze the video for a sec.
Sure.
So the main thing is that the cart and the track pull back, and I have, and so it's a stationary spot. So I come to the track. I have all my tools there, and the cart locks. And I all right, so right there. So the bottom where the wheels are, there's a little foot pedal in the back wheel. That cart can't move now. And it's stuck there. And only when John pivots, steps on the little foot pedal, we then can glide the cart and the piece back into the glory hole, where he very carefully heats, comes back out, and it's the wheel goes past the lever, and now the cart's locked into place. You see that dome right there, that round dome on the end of the blowpipe? Aaron, can you see that right in the middle?
Yeah, right here.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, that was the simplest little idea. I had a gizmo after gizmo trying to figure out how do you lift the piece in the air to elongate it without it sliding forward and smashing the floor. You put a hemisphere there, and on the tip of the yoke, when you tip up, the ball slides, hits the yoke, and you can spin. It's always the simplest design, the simplest of notions. It's about simplicity, right? That is what developed that. So again, I stand there at that spot with all my assistants jumping in, all the torches all around us. So this is the amphitheater where the surgeons operate, and people get to, this is my amphitheater where I create and do everything that has to happen. All the torches are behind us, enough said. So would you guys, do we have time? Is everyone here? Do you want to see I have a 1 minute video that shows this piece in completion. Would you guys like to see it? All right, so I've been working on this piece with Trish and the Imagine Museum for the last 2 years, and God bless everyone involved for help being a part of this collaboration. Truly, it's been an amazing journey. Gandhi with the staff.
I can't complain. You can create anything, Martin. I believe you can create anything in the possible imagination you have. It's amazing. Amazing.
Thank you. And it's you guys, it's Corey and Ferd and Aaron and Trish and everyone at the Imagine Museum who gives artists the opportunity to search and create. Everyone always is really curious. I bet you a lot of people are curious about the color blue. And I asked Trish one day, and it was really simple. She just looked at me and said, it's the color of the earth. It's blue. We're the only blue planet out there in for how many millions and millions of light years? We're the only blue planet. And I love that idea. I thought that is something to honor and the rarity of it. I mean, think about the moon. We have the moon rise, it's the earth rise. I mean, that's one of the most iconic images on of our century and the earth rise. Very, 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 very potent. That piece is gonna be installed in the Imagine Museum we're looking at around January or February. One of the biggest challenges about that piece was how does one create a landscape and not just have it on a pedestal, and how to create a stage set. And I created a staggering using three just raw slabs of steel. I just bought stacks of steel, a 3/4-inch steel. Each one of those little squares that holds that weighs about 50 pounds. And I sort of do a Duchampian staircase, the new descending a staircase. The sculpture, the base is as much a sculpture as the actual objects. And there's just four simple pedestals that hold this gorgeous cascade that is the amphitheater for the presentation of this visual poetry. So
Martin, I want to continue this, and I know you have a variety of bodies of work. I'm going to show some images of some pieces and take over people's screens. If you would tell us, just about the different bodies you've experimented with over the years. I can just show these images, but there's more than I have to show, but I want to just show some while we're talking real quick.
So this is the abstract the abstract landscape. This is these forms dealing with negative space. And I've been working on this body of work before Repose in Amber, which was 2004. Again, it's just an understanding of volume, form, content, color, refraction and a possibility to immerse yourself in your mind to see through the other side. I want everyone to walk around the piece, walk through the piece. And it's obviously very gestural and energetic.
I've seen these as singles and as giant sets, and the negative space is as important as the piece. And they have such beauty, and there's tones, different colors. It's an amazing body of work I wanted to share. Thank you, Martin.
Thanks, Aaron.
This is a newer piece, correct?
It's a piece that I had in my archive that I pulled out and refurbished. A Whisper in the Forest.
Beautiful, beautiful tones mixed with, I can see the nature in the wheat. And then it has that glass stand underneath it, a base that's like, is that cast? What is it?
It is a solid sculpted tree trunk that is, was just wonderful to, only with the wheel were we able to put clear masses together. And I cast bronze bark. I got walnut bark and cast it, and I stamp the walnut pattern into the bark. And this is silver leaf in these branches. This is the road. This is my moment of when I'm walking. And do you go to the right, to the left? And it doesn't matter. It's just move through it. And it's also the smell, the silence of snow. You know, the cacophony of the silence of snow. You know that? It's just deafening. It's so quiet. And the smell of the trees and the ice that's just clung and transformed itself onto the branches. And it's only there with 1 degree difference, and it's all gone. So that's what this piece is speaking to. It's that stillness and that moment of just pondering and just being.
A beautiful museum quality piece. Thank you for the, I love the snow and it's gone. You know, it's like the artwork you make and it's gone. It's,
I'm here and then I'm gone.
Right. Beautiful giant chandelier. I believe we have this piece in the gallery now. No internal lighting, right? It's just completely lit from the outside.
Exactly. But yeah, when I work with lighting, I try to not make a chandelier, but to make illuminated sculpture.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it is.
That's the terminology. 89 inches tall, hangs from multiple points. Beautiful. Thank you.
Thanks.
A newer piece called Reach. I saw some of these in your video.
Yeah.
Impressive. I remember what show years ago we had with you painting a man and a woman in our gallery, showing us your ability to control the human form. And it's beyond your fingertips. It's in your arms. It's in your back. It's in your head. It's in your legs and your toes. You know, I could barely get stick figures, and it's like it's just amazing the achievement you've reached.
I love to draw. You know, it's really interesting. You know, Pino Signoretto. You know, I don't know if you guys know this, but when I was 13, I started sculpting, and it was the one thing that really made me happy. I realized that I could. It just sort of resonated with me. I mean, anybody can make a hand. It's simply a patty with 5 sausages at the end. You know, but I wanted to be able to sculpt, and because of Pino and Bill Morris, I was able to learn. You know, I would always go home and sculpt, but I would then blow and work and design glass. And my first series was called the Janus series. It's because it was my other face. So, you know, it was more of a design. But the first hand I sculpted was life size, and it took me 7 hours back and forth into the glory hole and out. And I wouldn't stop until you could see bone and tendon and the softness and the tension in it. So I love sculpting hands. It's I still do. I sit down with a glass of wine, and you'll see a photo at the very end here. As my son puts it, my dad in his happy place. We're drawing crayons, eating at a restaurant, and we're all scribbling all over the table. I got a glass of wine in one hand and a piece of steak in the other, and I'm like, and crayons on the table. And I love it. My kid posted and said, my dad in his happy spot or his happy place.
That's fun. That's fun.
So this is from the Adorn series. You know, again, creating that visual poetry where there's a story to tell. The narrative of how do you see yourself and place yourself in the world? And it's your choice.
Yeah. You know? Beautiful stuff. Well, amazing what it does with light. Amazing.
Thank you. Yeah, it is all about light, right? It's mm-hmm. it's not just reflecting light like bronze. It's actually emanating light. The light goes in, the photons change it to a different frequency, and it projects back out. And God bless our eyes, and we have the capacity to see it and witness it. These are deconstructed blues. This is a new body of work where I actually sculpt the whole figure. And as a perfect figure, it's very Hellenistic pose right here. Classic. I mean, it's a You know, it's I don't know if you guys remember, but they're just sort of these figures that are just sort of exuberant. But I then made a perfect figure and had the courage to just start, cut it, deconstruct it. Giacometti said, cut the fat away, cut the fat away. And what that does is that gives one a facet to look into the piece. It's a window to look in and observe what's going on. Like a tree, you see the leaves, branches, bark, but you don't understand beyond the cambium is the deep structure that holds the whole piece together. Here in this piece, you see the sequence of time. If you see the first gather, the seminal gather, the moment where the piece starts in every gather, in every layer, in every layer. Yeah. It also speaks to a crystalline quality. The faceting creates a geometry that it's almost grown in that space.
And what's fun about these two is they rotate. You can explore them and move them around the stand on all sides and experience it different every day.
Yeah, that's right.
Martin's well known for his Lotus series of different bodies of work and sometimes dual pieces, other times singles. Very, very beautiful, peaceful pieces often. I see him in many, many collections and they're just stunning.
Yeah, thank you. You know, and the blooms are dedicated to their beauty. You know, it's a repetition and pattern. And it's also, you know, well, all artists, you know, I mean, think about how many artists have used flowers as a motif. And it's a lovely to create in a different style trying to break my personal tradition or patterns of work, but it's still very much, the sensibility is the same as a landscape. It's the space and the tension between the petals. It's the overall totality of the piece, the volume that the piece is capturing and speaking of. And it's also when you look into a flower, you remember this quality of nature, that it's a growing living thing. And I think it was again Emerson, I think, said something along the lines of flowers are God's way of smiling on the earth. You know, it's a lovely thing. Complete surprise. That piece is absolutely clear. Absolutely clear. There's not one stitch of color on it, but the gold bounces back the light in an opaque way. And Nicole Kepron was amazing at gilding these things. She'd spend weeks just putting layer after gold and it's just, you walk up and you're just, wow. And it's a light beacon. It's a light beacon of hope, a light beacon of happiness, and a light beacon of remembrance.
And a true treasure. That's awesome. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you, Aaron.
So
Mary Van Kline, God bless you, Mary, for having, again, this is her vision. She made this happen at SOFA. All the collectors, all of the curators, all the artists, all these wonderful souls were all immortal. You know, it's just this, just what I love this book. I can't wait to see it. You know, and I'm sure many of you have seen this, just capturing the essence of all these people.
Yes.
Really something else.
It's a lot of fun. So these are some more images, so, of your inspiration.
Can you give me let me just talk about it. Hold on 1 second.
Sure.
Back up 1 second.
Yep.
Okay. That is my beautiful bride, my wife of 32 years.
You jumped
and
into it.
What a journey. I came to Seattle with her for a 3-week job with Chihuly, and she's my girlfriend. And we moved here, and it has just been such a ride. And we raised two wonderful young men, Isaac and Torin, here. And I don't have photos of all of my friends and all of the people that have come into my life. This is just a really fast little thank you to my friends. Thank you to life. Thank you for everyone who shares what they love with me and with the rest of the world. So go ahead and just fire through these. This is nothing but joy. I'm not even going to say anything. Just go ahead and file it. The moment before the storm.
I know that guy. It's great. Just a bunch of positive love here, my friend.
Dan Clayman's piece. Unbelievable work of art.
Beautiful places you've been, people you've been with.
Top of the World Trade Towers. My kids and I, we always experiment. These are my orchids. I don't know if you noticed, but I grow all kinds of orchids. This is Finn. I'm going scuba diving this afternoon, you guys. Gonna go catch some crab.
That's great.
Dale, I love you, Dale.
More of your talent. We're gonna speed up these.
Great to see you guys.
Beautiful flowers. Martin, dirty, hard at work. Who's that guy?
That's the first moment we got to work with Lino, the very first Lino blow, you guys.
I had a feeling.
Man, my son did that shot. It's a burned book. How beautiful is that? That's the Bill and Melinda Gates Access to Learning Award. It's the first I made every year. That piece went to Finland for people who to support libraries. And these are all little pieces and surprises that you may never have known about. Yep, good morning. I grow bonsai, the tree in my slideshow I've been growing for 30 years. This is at the National Gallery in Washington, D.C. I love to play piano.
Great friendships, lots of great people you worked with over the years.
As I love, I live, my friend. That's all sweat. The Motley Crue.
What a team.
My Bodhisattvas, it's my high school buddy in Rue. My wacky son, my dear friend Dano. And I don't have all the photos. I just whipped it together. There's so many people that I don't have in here. I love to backpack. Oops, that was my 50th birthday. Froze my bajingas off. Lovely ladies, beautiful human beings. That guy got style. That guy's got style. That's Courtney. I love to ski. I love to remember. National Congress, Library of Congress, Kenneth Nelson. A mirror, a rear view mirror. My sister-in-law, Kathy, the woods. My son, Torn, Isaac, Marilyn. There it is, my great. Happy place.
That's great. Hope you took the tablecloth with you.
That's just love. Bash's beautiful, beautiful museum, school I created. This is my birthday party. We made this inflatable for my birthday.
That's great.
My mom and dad, eat like you give a damn. I do origami, you guys. I've been folding paper since I was fifth grade. I had the origami club, little robe man. These are our molds, just textures, patterns. I took that picture of Saturn. Guys, Saturn is really out there. It's unbelievable. This is the cart and the wheel. This is solid glass.
Wow.
This is just a sketch. This is a three-dimensional sketch. This is fluidity. Go look at that. It just wiggles and wobbles. It's just dancing. My dear friend, Albert Paley. Just be able to learn. Eli Hansen, huge help at the Museum of Glass. Ben from the museum, Michael Church, Evan Schaus. Look at this, this is you guys. This is Habitat, Gross's house. Look at that smile. Doesn't that just make you happy? It's making me happy. This is Hongo Jin Sensei, this is Japan. My dear friend Brian Kaur brought me to Japan. We created so many stories to share with you guys. The gang.
I think that's it. So a little housekeeping. Next week, we have Berta Valin joining us from Sweden to do one of these beautiful Habitat Nows. And again, I thank Martin Blank. I'm going to stop sharing. If anybody has any questions or comments, feel free to unmute yourself now. And thank you, Martin, for being part of this amazing presentation today.
Aaron, thank you, man. It's been a treat.
Thank you, Martin.
Thank you.
What a great life, Martin.
Thank you.
Bless you. Thank you. So inspiring.
You, Martin, you're an inspiration. Fabulous. We love you.
Outstanding.
Love you too. What a treat. It's really
love you, man.
Love you too. Have a wonderful afternoon, everybody. It's been really something.
Thank you.
It is something.
Well, thank you again, Martin. I appreciate you being here. This video will be recorded and put up on YouTube for those to enjoy and to feel free to share it. And I look forward to talking to everybody soon next week or anytime this week. Be well, stay safe, and thank you again.
Thank you, Aaron.
Thank you, Aaron. Thank you.
Oh my God, a flame of praise. Oh, thank you, you guys. That was the Burnix. That's the first sculpture right there. That is the very first figurative piece I ever made. At Sheldon Penny Burnick in the top right-hand corner. Oh my God. God bless you all for just loving art and loving humanity and the pursuit of the human spirit. It's been a great ride. You all take care. Have a wonderful weekend. Mwah.
Bye, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everybody.